I heard an old story.
Thank you for tuning in to the television ministry of Clay's Mill Baptist Church. Join us as we share our passion for soul winning, spiritual growth, and revival in our state and nation. And now, Pastor Jeff Huguet.
Well, good evening and welcome to the program tonight. Thank you so much for watching the television program from here at the Clay's Mill Baptist Church, 1220 Brannan Road. I am Brother Huguet, and my family, or most of them, will be with me this evening, my wife and Laura and three boys, and they'll be doing the singing in two different specials. Laura has a solo you're going to enjoy, and then they'll sing together as a group, and those will be a blessing to you. Let me tell you about what's going on here at our church. First of all, tomorrow is First Responders Sunday, and we could not pray enough or pray too much for these folks who serve us day in and day out. I appreciate our police departments. I appreciate our fire departments. I appreciate our EMTs and all of the folks that serve us under that heading, first responders. Tomorrow morning at 10:30, we'll be recognizing and honoring all of those that serve us in that capacity. Now, I would like to have the service outside, but it looks like we're going to have weather that will not allow us because of the winds. And if you get here tomorrow and you can't, and we're not having service outside and we're inside, and you come, you can stay in your car if you don't want to come inside the service, and you'll be able to listen to the service at 89.5 FM, or you can watch it Facebook Live on our church Facebook page. And I would love to be outside. In fact, last Sunday was absolutely beautiful as we recognized and honored all of our veterans. The temperature was good. The wind was light. Week before last, the temperature would not have been bad, but because of the high winds, made it very difficult outside. Most likely, we will be inside, but if we can, we want to be outside. I want you to say thank you to every police officer, every person that works in a fire department or an EMT, especially if you see them in a uniform or see them in their automobile that is provided for that particular service, and let them know we appreciate them. Not just tomorrow, but every day we ought to pray for them. Every time you hear a siren, every time you see flashing lights, you know that there is danger somewhere close. There's a need, there's a tragedy somewhere close, and we need to be in prayer for them. We've been a blessed nation because of these kind of people who serve us as they do. And so let's pray for them. Next Sunday, November 22nd, is the 56th anniversary of our church here at the Clay's Mill Baptist Church. And I am so grateful for God's goodness and many blessings in these many years. Just this past Sunday, even though we're in a difficult and a challenging year, this past Sunday was a tremendous, tremendous Sunday. More than 100 visitors in all of the ministries were a part of our church services last week. We had 25 people come to know Christ as Savior last week, and that's in addition to the personal soul winning. In all of these 56 years, God has been so mighty good to us. On November 22nd, we'll celebrate 56 years of God's blessings. And then on that Sunday evening, November 22nd, we will have an old-fashioned gospel sing. You'll hear our choir sing several numbers, and what a blessing they are. I love to hear them sing. And then you'll hear from the various groups in our church. We will sing together, you and I, and all of us in the church service. We'll enjoy the choruses, the spiritual songs, the hymns, and they will be a blessing. Service will begin at 6 o'clock and will go to the 8 o'clock hour on November 22nd. And I look forward to having you here with us. Now, on this Saturday evening, we're still unsure about the presidential election and even two of the Senate races, and so we continue to pray for our country. We continue to pray for our president. We continue to pray for the elections, and we desire that right will be done, and then we will move forward asking God to help us to serve Him faithfully in the days, months, and years to come, so long as the Lord tarries His coming. I look forward to the return of Christ. I look forward to the day that you and I will be taken to heaven. And of course, the reason the Lord Jesus tarries His coming is for those who have not yet received Him as personal Savior. If you're watching me tonight and you've never received Christ as Savior, I would encourage you even now to recognize that you are a sinner in need of a Savior. Unable to save yourself, unable to pay for your sin. And if your sin is not paid for, hell will be your eternal home. What a frightening thought. What a frightening truth. Oh, but the Lord Jesus died on the cross to pay for your sin. And the Bible says the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. The Bible says that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised Him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. I would encourage you even now in this moment to bow your head and to call on Him to be your Savior. Thank you so much for watching the program. If you're watching on Facebook, we would ask that you would share it to your Facebook page so others would be able to watch it in the days and weeks to come. And we appreciate those who do that each and every week. Here's the first special tonight, and then I'll be preaching from the book of Proverbs and chapter 1.
Oh, there's honey in the rock, my brother. There's honey in the rock for you. Leave your sins for the blood to cover. There's honey in the rock for you. Oh, my brother, do you know the Savior, who is wondrous, kind, and true? He's the rock of your salvation. There's honey in the rock for you. Oh, there's honey in the rock, my brother. There's honey in the rock for you. Leave your sins for the blood to cover. There's honey in the rock for you. Then go out through the streets and byways. Preach the word to many or few. Say to every fallen brother, there's honey in the rock for you. Oh, there's honey in the rock, my brother. There's honey in the rock for you. Leave your sins for the blood to cover. There's honey in the rock for you.
I'm preaching tonight from Proverbs chapter 1, and the text verse is verse number 5. The Bible says, a wise man will hear and will increase learning, and a man of understanding shall attain unto wise counsels. He goes on to explain what that means when he says to understand a proverb and the interpretation, the words of the wise and their dark sayings. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, but fools despise wisdom and instruction. My son, hear the instruction of thy father, and forsake not the law of thy mother. For they shall be an ornament of grace unto thy head, and chains about thy neck. I'm preaching tonight on three things that define and describe the wise man. I want to talk about these three things, and these build one block upon another. The first is that the wise man listens. Second is the wise man learns. And third of all, the wise man leads. The Bible defines the wise man. The Bible defines a wise man as the one who will hear instruction and one who will increase in his learning. The Word of God has much to say about the wise man, and it has much to say about wisdom. One could not preach a message on this subject without referring to that verse in James chapter 1 in verse number 8, where the Bible says, "If any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God that giveth to all men liberally and upbraideth it not." The Bible tells us much about wisdom and the wise man, and the Bible encourages us to be a wise man and seek the wisdom of God. Now, I'll not go deep into this study, but there is a vast difference between the wisdom of God and the education of man. There's a vast difference between the wisdom of God and the teaching and the learning, the theories and the philosophies of man. The Bible instructs us to listen to the wise man, and the wise man is one who has received wisdom from the Lord. When I was a boy, my mother took me to church even before my father started going to church. I've often joked and said I started going to church 9 months before I was born, and I'm grateful that I had the privilege to grow up in church and in a Christian home. I recall our first pastor there when I was a boy, Brother Clyde Jones, Jr. We attended the Bible Baptist Church of West 2nd Street in Xenia, Ohio. Brother Jones was just a model or a picture of what I thought every preacher should look like. I do not recall his age when I was a boy. If you'd have asked me, I would have probably said 75 or 80 when he probably was in his 40s or maybe 50. I do remember that he had white hair. I do remember that he always wore a dark suit. I do remember that he always wore shined shoes. I remember that he was always a Bible preacher. He was always saying, "Now this is what God says in His Word." My dad would sit in church and would take notes of all of the truths and the messages our preacher would preach from the Bible. I recall Brother Jones being a faithful witness and a soul winner for the Lord. He won many people to Christ. I had the privilege to be saved under his preaching. As just a five-year-old boy, I walked the aisle in the church receiving Christ as my Savior, and he baptized me in the church service there the evening after the morning I trusted Christ as Savior. I remember Brother Jones looking like what I thought a pastor should then and should now look like. He was a man that was very respectful, and he was a man that was very respected. I also watched as my dad, as I mentioned already, would take notes of Brother Jones' preaching. Now, our church was a good-sized church. Several hundred people attended the church there at Bible Baptist Church in West 2nd Street. I remember Brother Jones talking about inviting others to church and winning others to Christ. And I remember even as a boy watching my dad as he would take a pocket full of gospel tracts and go door to door and person to person giving out gospel tracts and working to win people to Christ. Now, I believed that my father was the wisest man I ever knew. Now, at this age, looking back, I believe he was a wise man, and he was a wise man because he listened to men who preached God's wisdom from God's book. In 1972, my dad started the Bible Baptist Church in Hazard in southeast Kentucky, and he followed the same behavior of his father. I remember everything about him was just like what we had done in our church when I was a boy before my father started the church. The church grew. The church sounded just like the other church. We sang hymns. He preached from the Bible. And it was amazing to watch that same thing transpire in our church in Hazard that I had seen happen at Bible Baptist Church in Xenia. My father would get cancer at the age of 38. He lived just 2 years and went to heaven at the age of 40, all the way back in 1985. All I knew to do as a preacher of the Word of God was to follow that same pattern that had been set forth before me from my father in learning from Brother Jones. As I read about the wise man and oh, how we need men of wisdom in our nation today. We need men of wisdom behind the pulpit. We need men of wisdom in the school classroom. We need men of wisdom in elected positions of leadership and representation. We need men of wisdom and women of wisdom in our world today. And I'm not talking about the ideas and philosophies of the world. I'm talking about the very wisdom of God. And as we look at this passage of Scripture, we learn three things about wisdom. First of all, we learn that a wise man will hear. In fact, we can differentiate between a fool and a wise man as one who will hear and one who will not hear. A fool seems to know everything. He seems to do nothing but fail, but yet he will not listen to change his ways. And yet a wise man, no matter how successful he is a man of listening. He listens to the wisdom of others. Listen to these verses from the Bible about this matter of wisdom and hearing. James 1:19, the Bible says, "Wherefore, my beloved brethren, let every man be swift to hear, slow to speak, and slow to wrath." Now, that used to be just a typical proverb of the day in our culture in America. Children were taught not to riot and not to run up and down the streets and not to break and things and burn things, but they were taught to be quiet and listen. They were taught when adults were speaking, children listened. Now, I know what the crowd is learning today, and I know how they're behaving today, and I see the direction of destruction our nation is headed in as well. But the Bible talks about this matter of wisdom and being quick to hear. Proverbs 19 and verse number 20, the Bible says, "Hear counsel and receive instruction, that thou may be wise in thy latter end." Proverbs 18 and verse number 13, "He that answereth a matter before he heareth it, it is folly and shame unto him." Just like we see the news media doing today, reporting on half-truths or what they think may have happened. The Bible tells us that a man doesn't speak if he's wise unless he knows what the truth is. Proverbs chapter 2, the Bible says, "So that thou incline thine ear unto wisdom and apply thine heart to understanding." Proverbs 25:12, "As an earring of gold and an ornament of fine gold, so is a wise reprover upon an obedient ear." A wise man listens to wise men. Have you noticed how many things are after your attention right now? Have you recognized how many different things are out there trying to get you to listen to it? There's the radio. There's the cell phone and a multitude of apps on the phone going from one to another, constantly working to get our attention. Their advertisements, their activities, their people, their relationships. We have to choose who or what we're going to listen to. Who we choose to listen to will have the greatest impact and make the greatest difference in our lives. The truth is, we look at time too much as leisure time But when we are listening to things, we're being influenced. When we're hearing people, we're being influenced. And the Bible tells us that the wise man listens to people of wisdom. How much time are we spending listening to the Word of God? How much time are we spending in church hearing the Word of God taught and preached? How much time are we spending listening to or reading a book that will increase our learning and our wisdom? We need not be fools in our day, as we have access to truth. We have access to wisdom. And oh, how important it is that we obey the instruction found in Proverbs chapter 1 about being a wise man with an attitude of listening. But that's not all. Not only does a wise man listen, the wise man increases in learning. It is one thing to hear, it is another thing to understand. It is one thing to hear someone teach or preach or the Word of God being read. It is another thing to receive. Jesus often said, "To him that hath ears, let him hear what the Spirit saith to the churches." He would often say in his preaching, "If you have ears to hear, listen." What was he saying? Was he talking to a group of folks that didn't have any ears on their head? Or was he talking to folks that had ears but weren't paying attention? Well, the latter is true. Most everyone could hear. And those that were dumb and those that were deaf, he made able to speak and able to hear. But he was saying, let's be people of wisdom. Let's listen to the truths that are presenting. Now, the Bible is not just a book of facts and figures. The Bible is certainly more than decoration for the coffee table. It is certainly more than a weight to hold down the doily on the coffee table. The Bible is a book of instruction. It is a book of wisdom. The Bible, to me, is like a cookbook. You don't read a cookbook just to read. You read a cookbook to do. And the Bible is like that, in that we read the Bible to do. We read the Bible to know what kind of attitude to have. We read the Bible to know what kind of thoughts to have. We read the Bible to know how to behave, how to forgive, how to love, how to exist in this world. The Bible is an instruction manual, like a manual you would purchase to learn to play an instrument. You don't read an instruction book on how to play the guitar just to read it, or how to play the piano just to read it. You buy an instruction book so you can learn to play the instrument, and that's what the Bible is all about. I've often said, I'm nothing more than an imitator, and I'm not interested in being an innovator. Now, what I mean by that is, I'm looking for wise men who are being blessed of the Lord, who are being successful in their work and saying, that's wisdom, that's what I'm going to do. That's wisdom, that's how I'm going to behave. That's wisdom, that's what I am going to think. James wrote in James chapter 1 in verse number 23, for if any man be a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is likened to a man beholding his natural face in a glass. The Bible says there's a lot of folks that look in a mirror just to be looking and just to be admiring. The Bible says the mirror is not just for looking and admiring. The mirror is to show us what needs to be changed, what needs to be fixed, what needs to be put into place. The Bible says later in that same chapter of James chapter 1, but whoso looketh into the perfect law of liberty and continueth therein, he being not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work, this man shall be blessed in his deed. And so he looks to see what needs to be changed, and he changes what needs to be changed to make it right. In these years of serving as a pastor, 34 years, and this past April, 35, this coming April, so about 34 and a half years, I've been a pastor. One of the things that I have worked to do in these years is have older men to come in and preach for us in our church. Not only did I want our folks to hear men of wisdom and men of experience, I wanted to learn from them as well. And so men of wisdom have been my teachers. The Bible said we ought to be listeners as wise men. We ought to be learners as wise men. And third of all, we need to be leaders as wise men. What does that mean? That means we need to lead in our own lives. Begins by personal responsibility. We ought to live by character. We ought to live by principle. That means we ought to be leaders in our own homes as far as our marriage, as far as our family is concerned. I challenge you to read more and study of this subject of wisdom and wise men from the Bible, and let's return to men of wisdom, learning wisdom from our God. Thank you so much for watching the program this evening.
Life carried me along. In my soul I yearned to follow God, but knew I'd never be so strong. I looked hard at this world to learn how heaven could begin. Just to end where I with all my heart, offered to the friend who took my place and ran a course I could not even start. And when he saw in full just how much his love would cost, he still ran the final between me and heaven, so I would not be lost, were it not for grace.